Hi everyone! In this video, I'm gonna show you how you can build a big city scene in Blender completely made of Lego bricks, without blowing up your computer. Hopefully, 3D Lego sets are very hardware hungry, and the bigger your scene gets, the more processing power you need to be able to work on such a project. And while even though I can't work miracles and it's always helpful to have a powerful computer, I put together 7 simple steps that will help you to keep your city scenes as light as possible. Step 1 is to find and prepare your models. You can find great Lego buildings on mecabricks.com. Just search for something like building, or modular is also a very good search term. Choose the buildings you like and go to the editor. From here you have 2 options. You can either export the model right away or use the editor to edit the model to be even lighter inside of Blender. What I mean by that is deleting all the stuff that is not absolutely necessary. For example, all the minifigs. We don't need them when we build the city. The good thing about doing this step in the mecabricks editor is that for a lot of sets you can select the whole figures here on the right side and don't have to select every piece by itself in Blender. In this case, there is still a little bit of manual cleanup necessary to get rid of all the stuff that the figures were holding in their hands. Okay, this looks good. Now, depending on how much time you want to spend and how light you want or need your models to be, you might also think about deleting most of the interiors of the buildings. You probably won't see any of it in your renders, and it will definitely slow down your performance. I'm also deleting this lamppost here, because I want to use a different design when I assemble my city inside of Blender. When you are done, export the model. As format, choose Blender add-on, and save it to your computer. Of course, you can also use the mecabricks editor to build your own houses. Another good site is rebrickable.com. There I found this guy called Funny Taco Bunny, who made great micro-scaled buildings, which you can use in the background of your scenes. And by the way, if you use models from different creators, don't be a dick and credit them when you use their work in your scene. To get these models into Blender, you have to first save the .io files to your computer and then import them into the mecabricks editor like this. From there, just export them like we did before. To open these files, you need the mecabricks add-on for Blender. You can either use the free or the paid version. The differences are mostly in the details on the bricks. In the paid version, you can add stuff like fingerprints and dirt. Also, the free version doesn't work with the EV renderer inside of Blender, so that might be something worth taking into account. Now we can finally move to Blender. Once you have installed the add-on, you can go to Import and select Mecabricks. Which brings us to step number 2, Import Settings. Those are more important than you might think. Here we have logo on studs, and if you are using the paid version also, bevels. Let me show you how big the differences are, depending on what you select. Look at the vertices count. The first one is a model imported without logo on studs and without bevels. The next one is imported with logo on studs activated. That's more than twice the number of vertices. That's a huge difference in terms of rendering. And 99% of these logos you can't even see. And the third one is with both logos and bevels checked. Almost 3 times the amount of vertices compared to the blank model. So depending on what you choose when importing big models can really make or break your scene. And visually the difference is really not that big. Here are 3 individual bricks side by side. So decide by yourself if those settings are worth the extra render time. Back to the import screen. There is one more option, the scale slider. This is more of a personal preference and doesn't really affect your render times, but I like to scale my models down to 0.001. By default, Blender works with meters as its scale unit, and by reducing the import scale, the Lego bricks will have their real life size. At a scale of 1, they are 1,000 times larger than in reality. And again, this doesn't influence render times, but influences how, for example, light sources behave, or depth of field settings, or even simulations. But it's really up to you. I will go with 0.001 for this tutorial. Now we have our house open in Blender. In case you didn't prepare your model inside of mecabricks, you can still do it here as well. For example, select those pieces on the roof and hide them with H. Now you can look inside and delete all the unnecessary pieces. If you want to spend the time doing that, press Alt-H to bring the hidden pieces back. Now it's time for step 3, assets. Turn everything into assets. This makes it so much easier when you want to build a large city. I'll show you how. Open the asset browser. You can see I'm using it a lot. I have assets for buildings, cars, streets, minifigures, and so on. To make your own, just right-click on the collection with your model inside and click Mark as Asset. To use your assets in every future project, you have to specify where your project is on your computer. So go to Edit, Preferences, File Paths. Under Asset Libraries, you have to enter the location of your project. Click the plus icon, make sure the file path is correct, and click Add Asset Library. Then you can give your library a new name. Make sure to save your preferences. From now on, you can select your library in this dropdown in every new Blender project that you create. You get this nice preview frame, which is not rotated correctly. Let me fix that quickly. Here you can reload the preview image. Now I show you what's so great about using assets. In this menu here, you want to select Link. So every time you drop an asset to your scene, it's just a linked object, not a real object. What this means is that every linked object is exactly the same. If I change anything in the original, it also changes in every other instance you have of that object. Why is that a good thing? Let's activate the statistics and look at the vertices. I can duplicate this asset as much as I want and the number doesn't change, so this is extremely nice when you build a city with a lot of the same houses. You can add multiple objects to your asset browser from one single blend file, so no need to create new project for every asset, although it might make sense to create additional ones once your first project gets too large and working and it becomes a pain. Also make sure to organize your assets. You can create folders for each category, like buildings and streets and so on, and simply drag them from the unassigned category to the new one. This little star icon means the changes are not saved, so let's save our project. Here you can see all the assets that I already created. Let me show you another way we can profit from the asset browser. On Mecabricks is a nice large city from Calwyn Brown Animation. Caution, this set is really, really big and it might take a long time to open it, but it has a lot of really useful models that we can turn into individual assets. This is the whole scene. Right now we are especially interested in these open buildings. When he made this set, he already kept it light by just modeling the parts of the buildings that are visible from the camera, which is a very good move and something we will keep in mind when we assemble our city scene. Let's see how we can use these buildings in the smartest and lightest way possible. Go to top view by pressing 7 on your numpad and select all the pieces. Better too many than too few. Then press C. Oh, I just noticed I don't have my screencast keys activated. I'm sorry. Press C and Shift to deselect all the pieces that are not part of the building. Right-click to leave this mode. Grab the building with G and see if you got everything. Right-click again to let go of it and then press forward slash to hide everything except those selected pieces. We want to separate this model into a ground floor and a first floor. So find a good parting line and select everything that is part of the ground floor. This looks good. Press M and move everything to a new collection. Give it a name and click OK. Now hide this layer and select the remaining pieces. Again, press M and move them to a new collection with a fitting name. We can now turn these collections into assets. You can find them in the unassigned folder in your library. But there is one important step to be aware of. When you turn a collection into an asset, said asset uses the world origin from the time you created it as its center point when you import it into a new scene. That's why we want to move each potential asset to the center of the scene. And now look at this. When we import the ground floor and move it to the world origin, then import the first floor and move it there too, it fits perfectly. But the real trick comes now. When you duplicate the first floor with Alt-D and move it up in one move, you can now press Shift-R to repeat your last command and stack floors as high as you need them. And because we are using linked duplicates, we are not increasing the vertex count in our scene. Pretty neat, right? Now you can hide this building, press forward slash and turn everything else you want into assets. For example, this traffic light, select all the pieces. Forward slash to hide everything. Move it to the center. Press M to move the bricks into a new collection. And create an asset. Repeat for as many buildings, cars, lights, and so on as you need. Congratulations! You are now ready to build your city scene. By the way, if you like what you are seeing, you might consider giving a thumbs up and subscribing. It helps my channel a lot. Let's start fresh in a new project. Don't use the blend file in which you created all your assets. Also, let's try to stay organized from the beginning. I want to start with some streets, so I create a streets collection. Open the assets browser. Go to my Lego libraries and choose the streets. By the way, these are models I build myself because I found the regular Lego street plates to be too small and the ones in Calwyn Street set to be too big. I put a link to my street models in the description below if you want to use them. Make sure to set your import method to link. You might notice that it's really hard to place a linked asset exactly where you want it in your first try. I have no idea why Blender behaves this way, but it is what it is. A good way to deal with this situation is to press Alt-G after you drag an asset to your scene. This moves it back to the world origin, and from there it is much easier to move it the location you need it to be in. Oh yeah, see these giant empty handles? You might get those if you imported your models with a scale of 0.001, like me. One way to fix this is by going to the object data properties and reducing the empty size. But that's not ideal, because you'd have to do this for every asset you import. If you want a more permanent solution, you can go to Edit, Preferences, Editing, and here you can change the instance empty size. Now every imported asset will have the small empty lines. Now I'll fast forward while I'm assembling some streets as our city's starting point. This should be enough for now, because you should never just start building before you know what you even need. Remember? We want to keep our scene as light as possible. That's why you should add your camera as soon as you can, so you know what will be visible when you animate your scene. No need to build a larger city than what is visible to the camera. I want my scene to be looking down from a rooftop across the streets, so add a collection for my buildings and drop a nice house to my scene. I want to put a figure on the roof, so I add a collection for all my figures. In the past, I rigged some random Lego figures and turned them into assets. Now this is different to importing lifeless objects. Because I want to move and animate this figure, I use append as the import method. That way it's not a solid linked object, but the original model with all its separate parts. Just make sure to go to this menu in the bottom and uncheck instance. Now I can select the rig. Go into pose mode and move and pose this character the way I want to. It's time to add a camera. Go back to object mode, collapse this fig collection and select the main scene collection and press Shift A. Add a camera to your scene. If you press Ctrl, Alt, Numpad 0, you move your camera directly to your current view. Press N to open your end panel, and under view you can check camera to view to further adjust your camera. I decided to lower my focal length to get a wider view of the city. If your models are getting clipped like mine here, make sure to adjust the clipping start and end points in the camera settings. If you were using your Lego models with an imported scale of 1, you probably need to increase the end points by quite a bit because everything is so large. Change it for the camera and also in the viewer node right here. You might want to open a second window just for your camera view. Hide all the gizmos and side panels and change the passpart 2 to 1. Also uncheck camera to view so you don't accidentally move your camera. In the other window you can now press numpad 0 to leave the camera view. Oh, and you might want to change the camera outline size as well. Fast forward while I'm animating a little dolly shot with the camera. Now we know how our scene is gonna look like and we can continue to build our city set. Again, only build what's necessary. Don't waste time, energy and processing power for stuff that isn't even visible, just like real movie sets do it. So let's keep building. Make sure to change your import method back to link and click the instance check mark again if you unchecked it like I did. So fast forward again, while I keep building. You know now how to do most of it. Keep in mind that for every new model you import into your scene you increase the project size just once, so you can duplicate as much as you want, but might want to limit how many different assets you use if you want to keep your performance good. I also made a small sidewalk plate. This is good for filling some gaps between the buildings. For buildings that are really far away, I like to use those micro-sized models that I got from rebrickable.com. I scale them up a bit, and that way they are really good to fill the scene without using too much geometry. They will be out of focus anyway. Another way to save geometry for blurry background buildings is to just import an image as plain. There is an add-on for that, that you just have to activate. Then you can press Shift A, Image as Planes. Select an image and place it in your scene. This, of course, is the most performance-friendly way possible, but it can be hard to find a good image with matching light and shadow settings and the right perspective. So for my tutorial scene, I'm sticking with the micro Lego models. Time to insert some ground elements like traffic lights, hydrants, bus stops, and so on. While I'm adding stuff to the ground, my performance starts to get choppy. So it's time for tip number 6, hiding collections. That's why it's important to stay organized. The buildings are by far the most performance-hungry elements, so just hide them while you work on other things. Even better than hiding is disabling the entire collection. This gives the greatest performance boost. Just keep in mind that disabled elements don't render when you want to export your animation. While unchecking the eye icon simply hides everything in the viewer, but is still included in your render. To finish the scene off, I'm adding some cars to the streets, and put them in their own collection, of course. Let's look at our scene in render mode. Right now the background is some random HDRI image that I set up in my starting file, so let's change that. I'm using a basic sky texture node to light the scene, but you can use whatever you like, an HDRI image or a sunlight or multiple light sources. If you don't see your background image, go to your render properties and under film uncheck transparent, or check it if you don't want to see your background image. Under color management, I reduced the exposure, because the scene is very bright. On the other hand, if you are using the Lego model scale of 1, you might need to increase your light strength quite a bit. I keep adjusting the sky texture until I'm happy. And now it's time for a first render, because I want to show you something. You see these buildings here? Look at their windows. What you are seeing is not a reflection, because those large buildings are hollow and open on the other side, you can see right through them. To fix this without using a lot of geometry, I like to use some basic cubes. So create a new collection called Cubes and press Shift A to add a cube to your scene. And now simply scale and move it so it fills the hollow buildings. Repeat for all the other hollow buildings. I also like to place a plane below my entire scene, so there is no sky visible in case I left some holes between my streets or sidewalks. So let's render the scene again and compare it to the first render. See how the buildings aren't transparent anymore and how the ground plane is blocking the light from below the scene to give some more realistic shadows on the rooftop in the foreground? And while we're at it, I'd like to add some more cubes just outside of the camera view to save on geometry, but to still cast the right amount of shadows as if there were buildings. This adds a lot of realism to your scene. And when speaking of realism, make sure to enable depth of field in your camera settings. When you want your scene to look like it was real Lego filmed with a real camera, you want a lot of blur, because that's how it is when you shoot real miniature scenes. When you have your models at 0.001 scale, any f-stop number between 1 and 25 is realistic. When you have your scale at 1, you can divide those number by 1000, so really, really small numbers. If you want to have your focus point visualized, you can check limits under viewport display. Then change the distance or pick a focus object in your scene to focus on. And that's it. All I did after this was animate the cars to drive forward and rendered my scene. So now that you can build your own Lego city, what to do with it? Maybe have Spider-Man swinging around in it. If you want to learn how to animate that, you can click over here to watch my web swing tutorial. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you found this video helpful. And I see you in the next one. Goodbye.